know. You know how we do. We gotta keep the pressure. We're New York, you know? New York can always keep the pressure.
Does it remind you of home?
No. I mean, but it's a good makeshift.
What's it missing, Paulie?
Real jerk-offs, you know? Real jerk-offs. And the old New York had like your good share of jerk-offs, you know? Like, even if you were proud, you were a jerk-off.
New York fighters. You know, if you're going to have a list of New York fighters and rank them, from best to worst, I mean, you're gonna have a bunch of arguments, and it's gonna be really, really tough, you know. So I try to think of New York fighters. When I try to think of New York fighters, I try to think of some of my favorites, you know, some of the ones that really stand out for me, that are personal favorites of mine. I think when it comes to great New York fighters, there's an endless quantity of them in every generation. And today we're actually gonna go over a lot of those. We're gonna be on the Vegas Strip discussing this. But before we get out there, you know, I want to go over my favorite New York fighter, and that was who was a big influence on me and my style. And that was Hector Camacho Sr., you know, Spanish Harlem's Hector Camacho Sr. If many of you paid attention to my career with the style, the speedy style, and the flash clothing, and just, you know, I was a little bit obnoxious and outrageous. Maybe not as obnoxious and outrageous as the Macho Man himself was, but, you know, I definitely had a lot of influence from Hector Camacho Sr. I thought he was a really tremendous fighter. If you watch this guy's career, watch him pre-Edwin Rosario fight, pre-1986 when he fought Edwin Rosario. I feel like he changed a little bit after that and still managed to win world titles after that. Don't get me wrong. It still was in major, major fights. But the Hector Camacho pre-Edwin Rosario for me is and literally an all-time great. I mean, post-Edwin Rosario, he's still a phenom, a guy that people will always remember, and I believe a Hall of Famer as well. But the guy before Edwin Rosario, the guy who, you know, probably was staying a little bit more out of the street. You know, the streets got to him, the fun life got to him, and of course, I think the Edwin Rosario fight also created a little bit of doubt in his boxing style, even though he won the fight. But watch the fight and you'll understand what I'm saying. He was clipped with a big shot late in the fight, and I feel like his mentality inside the ring changed after that. Nonetheless, watch any fight before he fought Edwin Rosario. He was an absolute phenom, super speedy. This guy's fundamental balance was unbelievable. Southpaw, flash southpaw to a T. I mean, this guy was a favorite of mine. You never knew what was going to come out of his mouth. You know, he always had something crazy, something outlandish to say. Even as he got older, you know, sometimes we get older, we kind of mature a little bit. And this is not even a knock on him, but he was exciting TV. Macho Camacho was probably reality TV before there was reality TV. If this guy could have somebody have been following him around all the time, he would have had his own show 24/7, and he would have been the number one hit on television. Be as it may, in his generation, he was still one of the phenoms in boxing, still one of the most well-known fighters of his generation. And for me, the pre-1986 Hector Camacho was also one of the best fighters ever. And for me personally, he was my favorite New York fighter, and he was a big influence on my style and my boxing style, and a big boxing influence on me. All right, man, so let's head out there to New York, New York, and discuss some more New York fighters.
New York, New York, the city so nice, they named it twice. And of course, yours truly, Paulie Malignaggi, is from there, so obviously I'm gonna have a special place in my heart for New York. But let's face it, when we think about New York and boxing, it's got a kind of a royalty feeling to it, right? I mean, this was probably the home of global boxing at one time. I think the best fighters in the world, when we think about the early 1900s and, you know, the first half of the 20th century in general, all the big fights were in New York. Fighters from all over the world wanted to come here. I mean, you can probably think of, if you've seen the movie Raging Bull, Marcel Cerdan was coming here to fight Jake LaMotta, and so on and so forth. I mean, yeah, sure, some of our fighters were going to Europe and all over the world, but in reality, New York was the hotbed where all fighters came to fight. I mean, you think about Joe Louis and Max Schmeling and places like that. I mean, it is royalty for boxing. So really, when you think about it, what am I gonna think? I'm saying to myself, who are the best fighters out of New York, right? I mean, I'd love to say myself, but it's far from it, right? But at the same time, what am I gonna think? What are you guys' favorite fighters from New York? What do you think when you think about New York boxing? The legacy of New York boxing. You think about the arenas, sure. You think about Yankee Stadium. You think about Madison Square Garden. You think about the Polo Grounds. You think about all that. But and even now, more recently, Barclays Center. But what do you think about as far as who are the fighters that really stick out in your mind? You know, You think about somebody like Sugar Ray Robinson, okay? Yeah, we're probably going to claim him a little bit. He's from the Midwest. He's from Michigan. I know everybody from Michigan. We're not stealing Ray Robinson from you guys, but we can't talk about having a boxing conversation and not mention Ray Robinson when it comes to all-time greats. Robinson was a guy who, you know, flashed himself out of Harlem. He had that pink Cadillac, known as a Harlem fighter. Yes, we know he's from Michigan, but we're going to kind of half-claim Ray Robinson as among the great New York fighters. Who else can we think of? I mean, we think of Jack Britton and his 37 title fights. I mean, this guy had 37 title fights in the early 20th century. I mean, these guys who have really good careers that don't even have 37 fights in general. So, you know, when you think about the old-time boxing, somebody like Jack Britton, you know, you think about maybe Tony Cancinieri and his winning world championships in three different weight classes, plus a good Italian-American, Paulie Malignaggi, you know, we're going to have to mention the good old Italian-Americans. Maybe Benny Leonard, a sharp-punching, hard-punching, crafty guy, one of the best fighters ever, and I think he had about 70 knockouts in 89 fights or 90 fights, something like that. Very crafty fight. One of the all-time best fighters ever. You know, so you think about New York. We're a hotbed of boxing. We were a melting pot of sorts where fighters of all different backgrounds and races and ethnicities have been champions all over the place. And granted, just like the New York field, we got the guy with the boombox right on the right here. You got Vegas in New York? You got New York in New York and you got Vegas in New York right here. New York, New York. The city's so nice they named it twice. Let's continue our conversation though. Moving over here. Because this guy's gonna boombox me right out of my own camera shot. You know? We think about more recent, not even more recent. Right after that, what do we have? We had Gene Tunney. Gene Tunney, one of the best heavyweight champions ever. Was he the beneficiary of the long count with Jack Dempsey? I don't know. You know, that's for you guys to debate. I think it happened almost 100 years ago, and people are still debating it today. But Gene Tunney, New York born, one of the best fighters from New York ever, and one of the best fighters in boxing history ever. Another guy who you think of when you think about boxing royalty in New York, and all the guys that have come out of New York and built that legacy in boxing. I think about guys, again, going back to my Italian-Americans, Rocky Graziano, Jake LaMotta, you know, Raging Bull is one of my favorite movies ever. And he's got a little R&B for you, a little R&B flavor for you. He's got back of my shot again. We know we're gonna have a little background music. Talk boxing, a little background music. Think about it like a ring entrance for you. You know, you got a ring entrance, you come in with your music, pump it up, get yourself pumped up. We're pumped up here. We're talking New York boxing, we're pumped up. I tell you what, Jake LaMotta, one of my favorites ever. Not just because obviously he's a Hall of Fame caliber fighter, but also Raging Bull, one of my favorite movies ever. If you haven't seen Raging Bull, you just need to see Raging Bull. It's a little old school for all of you that are a little soft and then get offended too easily, don't watch it. But for anybody that likes the old school and really wants that throwback feel, Jake LaMotta's story in Raging Bull is unbelievable. Robert De Niro played a great role. Joe Pesci, Kathy Moriarty, Frank Vincent is in that movie. It's a terrific Martin Scorsese movie. Raging Bull, the story of Jake LaMotta. Rocky Graziano also had a movie. Another terrific New York fighter in the middleweight division. Rocky Graziano had Somebody Up There Likes Me. Also a good movie. Check that one out as well. Raging Bull for me is the tops of New York, of not just New York boxing, but as far as movies, boxing movies in general. For me, it tops even Rocky. Because obviously, Raging Bull is a true story. You know what I'm saying? So for me, it's a great thing. Let's go to more recent New York fighters. You know, in the modern era, you know, you think about guys like Jose Torres, a Puerto Rican fighter out of New York. Really, made a lot of history, became a world champion, had a big following as well. Later, he became the president of the New York State Athletic Commission, I remember, when I was a kid. I don't know if Floyd Patterson was from New York. Maybe he might have been from upstate, I'm not sure. But Floyd Patterson was a New York guy as well. I don't know about New York City, though. You know what I mean? Tony Braxton jamming in the background. Shout out to Tony Braxton. You know, we got, and then, you know, recent guys, I mean, Riddick Bowe. I remember, now you were talking about guys when I was a kid, you know, guys like Riddick Bowe, Mark Breland, Aaron Davis and Mark Breland. New York was so hot that Aaron Davis and Mark Breland fought in a WBA welterweight world championship fight. Obviously, I'm familiar with the WBA world welterweight title because I held it myself, but in the early 90s, it was an all New York fight between Breland and Aaron Superman Davis for the WBA welterweight world championship. Davis knocked out Breland and supplanted him as the world champion. But of course, you can't mention New York boxing without an old New York title fight, right? You had guys like Junior Jones, who knocked out the undefeated Marco Antonio Barrera. I remember this. You know, Junior was kind of being brought in as an opponent after being upset and lost his world championship. Barrera was being hailed as the next Julio Cesar Chavez. Junior comes in and knocks him out. I think actually the official declaration was a disqualification, because Junior Pereira's team came into the ring and stopped the fight. But nonetheless, Junior Jones with a terrific win back then. Another great New York fighter. Brooklyn, nonetheless, you know. We think about New York, really, you know, it's five boroughs, you know. But all of them make up the city of New York. You know, we got Brooklyn, Bronx, Manhattan, Queens. Last but not least, Staten Island. You know, we even got, even recently, we had somebody like Marcus Brown who came out of Staten Island, has had himself a very good career. So no matter what boroughs you go through, we got some great New York fighters. In modern days, we've had Danny Jacobs. We've had yours truly, Paulie Malignaggi, and so on and so forth. You know, when you think about New York boxing, who are the guys that come to mind for you? You know, I'm sure there are guys that I've forgotten right now. I'm sure there are. I mean, if you ask me to make a top five list of New York boxing, which this movie was supposed to be, with this video was supposed to be, it's hard, man. I can't make a top five New York boxers, honestly, in history. I don't know if you guys are able to do that. But personally, myself, I start getting caught up in all the names and everything. You know, I'm going to have my favorites. I'm going to have guys that, you know, I may agree with myself one day, then I may disagree with myself the next day. I'm going to be arguing with myself. That's how many good New York fighters we've had. So I'm sure you guys are also going to have that same dilemma if you try to come up with a top five in New York boxing history and top five fighters in New York boxing history. But it's a city that is magnificent. It's been great to me. I pride myself out of being from New York, and I'm sure all fighters that are from New York, all people that are from New York, that especially that old school New York, have that pride, that flair in their ethnicity. So and their ethnicity and being from New York, really, the fact that we're all from New York is what unites us, regardless of the ethnicity. That's what made New York so great. And being successful in such a hard-nosed city, in a place that always was tough to come up in, you know, I feel like it's the reason why it has created such successful fighters and has been created such successful people in general. And we know, really, at the end of the day, New York boxing is going to create that royalty feeling. As I said, before, also, you know, it was the capital of world boxing, global boxing at one time. You know, let me know what comes up in your mind, guys. Let me know what you guys think of. Think of names, fighters that come out, stick out in your mind when you think of New York boxing. The arenas, you know, the places where they fought, you know, the stadiums, the arenas in general. I mean, for me, being a world champion in boxing obviously was a dream come true. But being a world champion and being able to rep my city and being able to be named among such great New York champions was also really one of the things I was most proud about. For all New Yorkers and non-New Yorkers out there, let me know what you guys think of your favorite New York fighters and your favorite New York memories. Back to the Every New York Boxing Conversation. Can't happen without one of the icons of my childhood, Mike Tyson. Iron Mike Tyson represents Brooklyn, represented New York, and really was one of the major stars in all of sports in the 80s. Personally, I can remember as a kid watching the preview show to Tyson versus Spinks and thinking, wow, I had heard about Tyson, and I'm 7 years old, and I'm thinking, I'm going to get to watch this guy finally. All the big talk I've been hearing about him as a kid, you know, you're very impressionable. Granted, when it comes to Mike Tyson, even adults were impressionable. Nonetheless, make a long story short, I've told the story a couple of times. I watched this preview show. I don't understand much English as I had been in the country not that long. I'm thinking I'm going to get to watch the fight as they're showing all the highlights. And instead, at the end, they tell you to buy the fight. Honestly, I didn't get to buy it because at 7 years old, my Italian grandparents weren't buying the fight. But the next morning, I remember going to the barbershop with my grandfather. He took me to him with him to the barbershop. And there were some newspapers laying around. And I can remember looking at the back page of the New York Daily News. And Mike Tyson, Michael Spinks was underneath the rope. And I could read I think it was 89 seconds or 91 seconds, I don't remember now, where he basically stopped them in half a round, you know? And it was a crazy, crazy situation there. It was a crazy thing to even see, because the night before, in my limited English, I had remembered this, getting so excited about this fight and thinking it was gonna be a major fight. And now, just seeing Spinks on the canvas like that, right underneath that rope, it was just an impressionable moment of my childhood. Mike Tyson became larger than life. And for all boxing fans, really, that lived through the Mike Tyson era, he was larger than life and iconic. But especially if you're an 80s kid, this guy right here was the man. So no New York boxing discussion can happen without many fighters. Mike Tyson, for me, being the most iconic one, because I'm partial, I'm an 80s kid, and this was the guy. The Italian-American experience in New York. Paulie Malignaggi, boxing, synonymous. Always Italian Americans and boxing, especially back in the day. Granted, nowadays I pretty much was the only representation of Italian Americans in boxing on a high level in New York, out of New York. But back in the day, we were largely represented. We mentioned Tony Canzanieri already. You know, in the 50s, we had Rocky Graziano, we had Jake LaMotta, and you can't have an Italian American conversation in New York without, of course, Mulberry Street, the home of Little Italy. These guys were iconic in many ways. Jake LaMotta has a movie after him. My favorite boxing movie of all, Raging Bull. Robert De Niro played him. Joe Pesci's in the movie. Frank Vincent's in the movie. Kathy Moriarty. If you haven't seen it, crawl out of the rock that you've been hiding under and watch Raging Bull. It is the best boxing movie you can see. The other guy that I'm thinking right off the bat right now in this around the same time frame, Rocky Graziano, another former middleweight world champion, just like Jake LaMotta. Graziano also had a movie made after him called Somebody Up There Likes Me. Personally, I don't like it as much as Raging Bull, but still, another must-see if you're into the old-school nostalgia for boxing and for old-school New York movies. Regardless, the Italian-American experience in New York, in boxing, was larger than life in those days. Like I said, we mentioned Canzinari, a larger-than-life figure. LaMotta and Graziano were larger-than-life figures. The Italian-American experience at that time was larger than life. We were a growing community, and these guys set the building blocks for guys like me to come along later on.